Think about the last time you put gasoline in your car. Let's assume for now that you drive a standard gasoline-powered vehicle. If you use a bicycle or an electric car or biodiesel or some other alternative fuel vehicle, just play along with me for right now. Now think about this question very carefully and answer. As far as your car is concerned, what is gasoline? Okay, so now if your answer was energy, well, sorry, but you're wrong. Energy is not a material substance that you can touch or carry or pump into your gas tank. But that doesn't mean that it's not a real thing. Energy is real, but it's fundamentally different from matter, which is the stuff of material substances. And in fact, the word matter and material share a common root. If your answer to my question was fuel, give yourself a gold star. A fuel like gasoline is a material substance, not energy. But it would be accurate to say that gasoline is a substance that represents a great deal of chemical energy potential. When we use substances like gasoline for fuel, we're taking advantage of the way that energy gets released when high energy potential substances like gasoline are converted into low energy potential substances, and we usually call these waste molecules. Carbon dioxide and water are the waste molecules left over after we combust gasoline. This conversion results in the release of energy. The energy being released will typically be manifest in some combination of heat as well as work, which in the case of the energy released from gasoline in your car's engine means the work of physically moving you and your car from place to place. Point is, you can't achieve work without the input of energy. And in a physics class, you would learn that the work is equal to force times distance. Think of the force that must be applied by your car's motor in order to move you and your car, times the distance that you travel in your car, and that's the scientific definition of work. Note that, in a different situation now, if you were coasting from the top of a hill down to the bottom of a hill, this would not be considered work because you don't need to exert any force over that particular distance. No energy is required, and in fact, you could achieve that amount of downhill distance traveled without any consumption of fuel or any output of energy. Okay, so now back to the biology class. In the cellular context, the term work applies to any cellular activity that requires the input of energy. One form is mechanical work, which is the same as the physical sciences use of the word. With nearly every movement you make, you're exerting a force over a distance, and this requires energy input in order to power whatever muscles are used to make that movement happen. An exception to this would be the movement of falling, say, out of your chair because you're dozing off as you're listening to this. That part of your movement in going from the chair height to flat on the floor would not require any energy at all. However, if you're going to do anything to break your fall, like extending an arm out and applying pressure to the floor so you don't land too forcefully, this would require the input of energy, and it would be work. Another kind of work that we've talked about at length in a previous module is transport work. That's the pumping of ions or some other solute from areas where they're at lower concentration into an area where they're higher concentration. And I'm guessing than really hoping that you really don't need me or want me to go into the differences between active transport and facilitated diffusion again. But if you need to go back and review those sections, please go right ahead. Yet another kind of cellular work that is very important is chemical work. Earlier we addressed this point when we talked about the anabolism of polymers from monomers. Remember that macromolecules are often constructed out of organic building blocks, and the process of dehydration synthesis was said to require the input of energy. This would be an example of chemical work. The opposite reaction, the catabolic breakdown of polymers making monomers via the process of hydrolysis, is not energy requiring, and it would not be an example of chemical work. This would be more like the example of the car rolling down the hill with no exertion of force. Now let's go through a specific example involving glucose and starch. You should know already that starch is a polysaccharide comprised of many molecules of glucose that are covalently bonded together in long branching chains. Now in a plant, where the glucose is being produced by photosynthesis in all the green parts of the plant above the ground, a lot of the glucose gets stored in the form of starch molecules. Think of a potato plant photosynthesizing in its leaves up here in this part and sending all the glucose down to the tubers where they're polymerized into the starch of a potato. The cells making the starch out of the glucose must provide an outside energy source in order to drive this polymerization reaction. Now say you dig up that potato, clean it, and bake it for your dinner. When you eat the potato, the enzymes in your digestive tract carry out the exact opposite reaction of polymerization. Hydrolytic enzymes, like the amylase in your saliva, break down the starch into molecules of glucose again. But this being a catabolic reaction does not require an outside energy source in order to make it go forward. What the plant is doing when it makes the starch is an example of cellular work, while what you're doing when you digest the starch is not work, because no added energy is required. Now, the real reason why dehydration synthesis reactions tend to be energy-requiring work, while hydrolysis reactions are usually energy-independent, non-work, has entirely to do with the covalent bonds that are changing as a result of the chemical reactions. The two glucoses shown here won't undergo a dehydration reaction on their own because their bonds are more stable when these monosaccharides are separate. A nice, easy metaphor that we can use here is that the energy required to put together two molecules of glucose, rearranging their covalent bonds and releasing a water molecule, is like a little bit of glue. If you keep on gluing more and more glucose molecules onto the end of the chain, you can end up with a starch-like polysaccharide, but only if you provide the necessary glue. The general rule here is that all such anabolic reactions require glue, which, as you remember, means energy. Sometimes, however, you can have the monomer units coming in with their own glue, kind of like these little figures cut out of Post-it notes. No outside glue is required because the building blocks come with their own adhesive, prepared to stick to the next molecule. So you can form chains without having to worry about adding energy from an outside source if you start off with monomer units that come pre-charged with their own energy. Well, this example of pre-glued monomers is kind of like the way that we synthesize nucleic acids. Remember that RNA and DNA are made of monomer units called nucleotides. The basic nucleotide structure consists of a nucleoside, that's the sugar and the base, plus a phosphate group that forms the bridge that connects the sugar parts in the nucleosides together, making a long chain of sugar-phosphate-sugar-phosphate. When we have to make RNA or DNA, we always start off with nucleoside triphosphates. That's the regular nucleotide with a string of three phosphates instead of just one. Those extra phosphates represent the glue that will be used to stick together the nucleotides. Keep in mind that we end up with only one phosphate between the sugars in the chain. Those extra phosphates represent potential chemical energy, the glue that will stick the monomers together. But you could also say with perfect accuracy that the triphosphate version of the nucleotide has two extra phosphates that act as a mini fuel pack to provide the energy needed to drive the chemical work of synthesizing the polynucleotide. By starting off with nucleoside triphosphates, we don't have to add any outside energy or glue when we make RNA or DNA. Well, one of those nucleoside triphosphate packets of potential energy, the one with ribose for sugar and adenine for the nitrogenous base, is a molecule known as adenosine triphosphate, or ATP. And this is used not only for RNA synthesis. It has actually become the gold standard for storing nearly all of the energy that we get from food. And it provides this energy to the cells that drive basically all the forms of cellular work. ATP is that outside energy source that we were talking about in the first part of this video. You could say that we are like our cars in the sense that we need fuel in order to meet our energy requirements, and we use the food that we eat as this fuel. Now, there are many kinds of food molecules that we use for fuel, and they have varying amounts of potential energy. But the energy potential of the food molecule is not directly usable by the enzymes or the transport proteins or the motor proteins, the molecules that carry out our cells' work. Instead, these protein workhorses of our cells require energy input in the form of ATP, a standard packet of fuel that interacts well with proteins and doles out an appropriate sized chunk of energy where it's needed and when it's needed. We're going to be focusing a lot on ATP in this module, so get ready.